Students, welcome back. Today I am going to explain you pollination and adaptation, special adaptations of pollination. Students, as you know that pollination is a transfer of pollen grains from one flower to another flower or from anther to stigma. So there are two types of pollination. Number one is self pollination and cross pollination. Self pollination, you know that transfer of pollen grains from anthers to the stigma of same flower. But in cross pollination, pollen grains of anthers of one flower will be transferred to the stigma of another flower of another plant, and that they require some agents. So those agents are of various kinds, either that is of wind, water, birds, animals, and insects. So one by one we will discuss all this in detail, and for this let's start with the cross pollination or agents of pollination. So students, as you know that in cross pollination, pollen grains are required to move from one place to another place. For that purpose, they need some agents for their transfer. So in this video, we are going to discuss about the agents of pollination. So let's start with this one. Before going to next topic, I want to tell you that agents or vectors responsible for cross pollination are of two categories. Number one, abiotic. Number two, biotic. Abiotic means non-living type of agents, for example wind and water. Wind and water can also carry pollen grains from one place to another place or from one flower to another flower. And biotic, there are insects, birds, bats, snails, some other animals are able to transfer pollen grains from one flower to another flower or one place to another place. So one by one we will discuss in detail all these types of agents. So students, first of all, cross pollination is named after the agency that assists it. So according to their agents, there are different types of cross pollination. Number one is anemophily. Anemophily means pollination done by wind, that is wind pollination. And then second is hydrophily. Hydrophily means water pollination. And third is entomophily. Entomophily means insect pollination. Fourth is ornithophily. Ornithophily means bird pollination. Then chiropterophily, that is bat pollination. Then melacophily, that is snail pollination. So these all type of pollinations are there, but we are going to detail about the first three pollinations: anemophily, hydrophily, and entomophily. Rest all their name is enough for you. Now next one is first one is anemophily or wind pollination. Students, pollination done by wind means some flowers are there which are whose pollen grains can be transferred by the wind only. So there are lots of plants, for example grasses, sugarcane, maize, bamboo, coconut, palm and cannabis. These all are having pollen grains which are having special characteristics, means flowers having special characteristics to produce pollen grain which can be taken up by the wind to the various places. So let's start by taking one example, that is maize plant. Students, before going to the example, I want to tell you some special characteristics of wind pollinated flower, means you can say that anemophilous flower. So anemophilous flower, in which wind is a pollinating agent, flowers are colorless, without fragrance, and without nectar, and very small in size, no color is there. And along with this, pollens are light, dry, non-sticky, and sometimes winged also. They have a wings for flying into the air. And third thing, they are always they can be blown up to very long distance by the wind only. So let's start with this maize plant. We are going to take up example of maize plant. So students, this maize plant is having two types of flowers are there. On the top you can see there male flower is there, male flower. This is a real picture of male flower, you can see here, called as tassel. actually a particular name is there, tassel. And then this tassel is colorless and produce large amount of pollen grains, so that you can say that 25 million pollen grains can be produced by a tassel of maize plant. Tassel means it is a cluster of male flower, cluster of male flower. So next one is, you can see here, this one is female flower, female flower, where style, female flower, and style is hanging outside. Lots of styles are there, and these styles are hanging outside, elongated styles, we can say that, styles, elongated styles are there, and the tips of these styles are called as stigma. If you will see here, the tips of this one is called as stigma. Stigma. So students, these are the different male and female flowers, and along with this, this male flower will produce lots of pollen grains. You can see here, so many millions, as I told you, 25 million pollen grains can be produced by this tassel of a male flower, and these pollen grains will reach to the next plant only, not on the same male female flower, but to the next one. Suppose this one is another plant, so that will reach to the another plant, and there only this pollen grain will settle on stigma. So if you will see there, so lots of pollen grains will collect over here, and then they will settle on the stigma, and fertilization can be done. So this is all about your wind pollination, and this pollen grain will be taken by the wind to the another plant, and their stigma, their female flower stigma will be pollinated, and that pollen grain will landed on the stigma, and then pollination will be done, and further process fertilization can be done there. So this is all about your wind pollination. Now next one, we are going to discuss about the hydrophily. Hydrophily means, students, water pollination. Water pollination means transfer of pollen grain from anthers of a flower to the stigma of another flower through water. Through water, this flower, stigma reach to the surface of water, and then I'm going to explain you about this one. Suppose on the ground there is a dust particle, means it is a river bed or pond bed, and then we have a one plant over here. You can see plant is shown over here also, Vallisneria plant. We are going to take a example of Vallisneria. Actually, Vallisneria is a very good example for the water pollination. So this is a plant, and we can say that Vallisneria, which is going to be explained over here. So I want to write over here the example, Vallisneria. This is a plant, Vallisneria, and this plant will be growing under the water, and it has a two parts. You can say that I am going to make one plant over here. Suppose these are the leaves of Vallisneria, long leaves are there. These leaves actually present there, and then there are two types of flowers. One is male flower. I'm going to make one male flower, just representing only, students, that male flower, and here lots of male flowers will be produced from this group, and another is female flower, and that female flower will be produced from that structure. You can see that this is female, and its style is very long, very long. And on the top, suppose this is a top surface of water. Suppose this is a top surface of water, then this style will reach up to the top surface of water, and it will convert into stigma. Stigma will be bilobed, like this. Bilobed stigma will be there, and then this style is formed. Students, if you will see that style will be very long and curved. I want to show you style. When you will make a style that this, I want to show this properly so that you can draw and do the practice of this diagram also. When the female flower, when the female flower will be forming here, then flower will be remaining here only, and its style will be very coiled, so much coiled and elongated, and reach up to the surface, and the stigma, that is bilobed stigma, will be forming there like this. Very much coiled style is there. This is style, and here is stigma. So students, afterwards it's pollen grains. Pollen grains will be formed. Look at this pollen grain. Actually, this is male flower. You can see here male flower is shown. This male flower will reach up to the surface of water, and they will be floating on the surface of water like this. Boat like structure they will form, and then it will be floating on the surface. And when they will come in contact with the stigma, these flower will be coming in contact of stigma, then these flowers enter into the stigma, and then they will rupture there, and pollen grains are released. Then the stigma will be closed, and the style will be curl down, and then style will come down under the water and reach near the soil, and the seeds will develop over here, and then new plant will grow over here. So like this pollination will be done, and that is shown here. So you can see here that it is a mature male flower get detached from the parent plant and float on the surface of water, owing to the opening of the perianth into a boat like structure. At the same time, female flower rise to the surface of surface by strengthening of its stalk, or you can say that style will be strengthened or reach to the up to the surface of water, and then pollination will be done. So this is all about your valley scenario. And students, at the end, after pollination, the female flower will close and their long stalk curls up and drawing the flower below the surface of water down into the mud, where seeds and fruits ripen and new plant can grow there. So this is all about your water pollination or hydrophily. So let's start with the next topic, that is entomophily or insect pollination. Students, you know that insect pollination is mostly done by the insect. There are various insects, for example moth, bees, butterflies, ants, so many are there, those who are helping in pollination. And some plants are totally dependent on insect pollination. So both are important. Plants are also important, and insects are also important for their survival. So students, we are going to discuss some special type of adaptations in case of entomophilous flower. But before going to that, what are the common adaptation, common features of the entomophilous flower? That must be a yellowish, that must be a brightly colored, large, and they must have some nectar or fragrance or odor so that they can attract insects. And secondly, they must develop their petals and sepals into a attractive coloration, very showy and attractive. And afterwards, the pollen grain must have a sticky and sticky in nature so that it can be stick to the insect body easily. So so many plants are getting pollinated by the insect, but I am going to take here only some special adaptations in some entomophilous flower. So first one is salvia. We are taking the example of salvia. In salvia, first of all, I want to explain you the salvia's structure, salvia flower structure. So first part, that is A part, you can see here the flower is tube like this. Tube is there, you can see here tube is there, and it's from the starting it is tube like, but at the tip it will convert into two. One is hood like structure, and another is platform like structure. You can see this like this. So this flower is there, and inside the flower you can see here This is a first part. First of all, I want to explain you about the male part. In male part, you can see the lower part of the flower is called as this is called as plateform. The lower lip. Lower lip means the lower petal, and the upper petal is called as hood. Upper petal. This one petal is called as hood. So this lower lip is a plateform where the insect will come and sit. And inside this, first of all, androecium, the salvia flower is a protoandrous type. Protoandrous means first, androus means androecium. Androecium will develop first. In young plant, androecium will be developing first, and they just get mature early, and then the insect will come and sit on the plateform of the flower. Then it will press the actually the stigma and androecium is having two parts over here. One is upper part, which is called as fertile anther, and the lower part, smaller one, is called as sterile anther lobe. This sterile anther lobe and the fertile anther lobe, they both are present in one flower. The lower sterile anther lobe is towards the lower lip, and fertile anther lobe is towards the upper lip, that is hood. And students, whenever the insect, you can see here, the insect is there. This insect will sit on the lower lip, and it will press the lower anther, sterile anther, and they just put their proboscis to suck the nectar. And when they will press this lower anther, then that upper anther will come to touch the back of the insect, and then pollen grains will settle on its back, and then this insect will be having the pollen grains. It will take the pollen grains and go to some mature flower. Where in mature flower, anther will not be there, but gynoecium will be fully developed. In that mature flower, old flower, you can say that gynoecium will be well developed. When this insect will sit, you can see here, gynoecium will be well developed. When the insect will be coming and sitting over here again on the lower lip to get the nectar, then this gynoecium stigma will be touching the back of the insect and getting pollinated. Pollen grains will stick to the stigma, and then it will get a pollinated. So this is all about your salvia, one case which is very common and very important for the plus two students. This diagram you do practice, and explanation also you can write a note and then prepare it. Along with this, one more special case in case of insect pollination, that is yucca plant. In yucca plant, there is a flower. You can see the original flower is also shown here, and this is a yucca plant in which Pronuba is a moth which cannot live without a yucca flowers, and yucca flowers have no other pollinating agent. Both are obligate symbiotic relation. They both are in obligate symbiotic relationship. So students, obligate symbiotic relationship, and they dependent on each other. So you can see the original picture. This Pronuba moth is coming, and it is sitting on the style. When it will sit on the style, actually whenever the Pronuba moth will reach to any flower, then it will carry pollen grains in the form of ball. That ball will be stick over under side, and then that when it will be enter into the any flower, it will reach to the stigma style, and then it will press that ball like pollen grain will be enter inside this stigma will be settled on the stigma and get inside the style, and by this method it will pollinate. Along with this Pronuba will lay some egg inside the style of this inside the ovary of yucca plant, and those eggs will hatch there, and the larvae will eat on the seeds of this yucca seeds, and then this pollination will be done with the help of Pronuba, and Pronuba's eggs will develop inside the yucca flower. So this is about the yucca plant. Very obligate symbiotic relationship is there between them. Both are dependent on each other. And next one is students, one more special case in case of flowering plant, flowers, that insect pollination, that is Hypanthodium inflorescence. In plus one also you have read about the Hypanthodium inflorescence. You can see here I am going to draw one structure, how Hypanthodium pollination, Hypanthodium has one opening over here. Only one opening is there and round structure, and inside this there are some male flowers, female flowers and neuter flowers are also present, means you can say that those are called as sterile flowers. And this one opening only for the pollination, for entry and outgoing outside. So that, like this, you can see the seeds are visible over here, these seeds are visible over here, and the this one insect is also visible. This insect will be growing inside the flower only, inside this fig. And very good example is fig. Ficus, lots of plants are included into the ficus family, but fig is very good example. And its insect which is pollinating it is called as Blastophaga. This Blastophaga is mostly entering from this area. You can see here there is a one opening in Hypanthodium type of inflorescence. The opening is one. From here it will lay its egg inside the inside this part where lots of male, female and neutral flowers are present. When it will be entering inside, then its abdomen will enter inside, then it will lay egg, and when the pollen grains will stick to it from one flower, and then in another flower it will lay, it will shed those pollen grains over the long style containing female flowers, and then pollination also done along with the Blastophaga will release, they will lay their eggs inside, and the larvae will develop there and they will eat on their seeds. So this is all about your ficus. So students, these are the special conditions, special adaptations of some plants which do their pollination with the help of in some special insects. So this is all about this topic. Hope you understand well. And students, as I used to say that please go through your book and read your book properly to assimilate this topic well. And students, this all the topics are very important for your board examination. So next time I will come with next video. Thank you.